Majority Report with Sam Seder. It's time to look in the mirror, America. Do you like what you see?
I keep referring to Obama as the magic Negro.
Do you like what you see now?
Well, suck on this.
It's just a mirror, America.
Shared sacrifice by everybody.
What could it do to you except reflect your image?
I did nothing wrong at the Minneapolis airport.
The Majority Report.
Far more credible to me than PBS
and Frontline.
The Majority Report with Sam Seder.
If I get the feeling you've been cheated.
It is Thursday, August 25th, 2016. My name is Sam Seder. This is a four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live to tape steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, journalist Paul Tough, author of actually multiple books, ladies and gentlemen, including his latest, Helping Children Succeed. What works and why? We talk a lot about education on this program, a particularly important issue, because either you listening to this show have been educated, or someday you'll have kids who need to get educated. And really, frankly, if you're interested in the future of the country, education has to be sort of your primary concern.
Just so long as it doesn't include math.
Well, I would completely exercise math from the entire curriculum.
Yes.
Paul Tough has written multiple books on education, including How Children Succeed, Grit, Curiosity, and the Hidden Power of Character. And this one is Helping Children Succeed. So I started off the interview, and I used to know Paul, you know, I mean, not really well, but I knew him fairly well, like, years and years ago. And I haven't been in touch with someone for that long sometimes. So I tried to start off the interview with a joke about, like, how children succeed, helping children succeed. Couldn't you come up with a new title? Like, it just, I felt like, and it,
that joke. Friendly joke.
Friendly joke.
Good opener.
Good opener. Maybe not.
But maybe not.
It didn't.
I actually think it's a little
nevertheless,
shabby.
The book is fascinating, and I mean, I think it's particularly fascinating to me because I have kids in public school, but it also is really important in terms of when we talk about education reform, the educational reform movement in this country, the so-called education reform movement. It is stunning to me how much money is involved in it, how singular their focus has been, and how I think wrong they've been about so much. And Paul comes at this with from a very sort of non-ideological basis, really just dug into the science, to the neuroscience, if you can believe it. We didn't do any thought experiments.
As long as there's no math.
No math.
Or thought experiments.
Absolutely no math. And of course, even though I'm on vacation today, you guys are getting a new interview, and there'll be a member's pick from Matt. I don't know what it's going to be. You don't know what it's going to be. I don't even know if Matt knows what it's going to be. God knows what he's going to be coming up with.
I have no idea.
No idea.
I'm unpredictable.
So I'm on vacation. Am I worried about my home being burglared? No, I don't really worry about it too much. I think it's worse in areas where, like you're out in the suburbs maybe. But I can tell you what I am doing, for at least because I know me. I know what I am doing. I am actually watching my home via video. And how am I doing it? I'm doing it with Ring. Most burglaries happen in broad daylight, with a burglar ringing your doorbell to make sure you're always you're away before they break in. Well, Ring Video Doorbell has been proven to stop burglaries before they happen by allowing you to see and speak to anyone approaching your door using your smartphone. Ring is using their advanced motion detection to protect your entire property with the Ring of Security Kit. The kit includes a Ring video doorbell on the front door, a Ring stick-up cam, which also has an ability to be powered by solar. That, to me, is a huge selling point. The wireless weatherproof HD camera to keep an eye on other parts of your property. I just like to look at the stuff. The Ring video doorbell and stick-up cam both install in minutes. Working together, they provide 24/7 monitoring of your entire home, whether you're in your living in the living room or thousands of miles away, where I am somewhere in between. Also, let's say you have an office and you know that maybe while you're gone, one of your employees, I'm not going to name any names, Michael, comes by here to sort of show off the place, to make themselves, you know, like, oh, that's the seat I sit in, and I have a microphone, and look at the backdrop.
I don't really know that there's that much of a
someday
tour.
This is all going to be mine, and no. Just a way
someday of I'll foreclose on all of this and shove it out of business.
I've already got my HR suit planned, and it's all going to be mine, and, well, if you've got that going on in your office, you could also set up one of these in your office and see your employee doing that, Michael. Join the hundreds of thousands who protect their home with Ring. For a limited time, my listeners get $50 off the Ring security kit. It's the lowest price anywhere. Go to ring.com/majority. That's Ring, ring.com/majority, like as in Majority Report. Go to ring.com majority for $50 off. ring.com/majority. All right, going to take a quick break. When we come back, Paul Tough.
Friday. That means Monday is Casual Monday. Tuesday, Casual Tuesday. Wednesday, Casual Hump Day. Thursday, Casual Thurs. That's what we call it. And Friday, Casual Shabbat. The Majority Report with Sam Seder.
Oh, it's Casual Friday. My name is Sam Seder. This is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live to tape. Steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. Oh, it's the final day of our vacation. Woe is us. Woe is us. Maybe woe is you, because we've given you all new material the whole week. Maybe you've loved it. Maybe you wish it wouldn't stop. I mean, we're going to give you new material next week, too, but I don't know. I'm not a mind reader. Stop expecting me to always know how you're reacting to things. It's the final day of vacation, folks. On today's program, David Daly, author of Rat Effed, the true story behind the secret plan to steal America's democracy. This outlines how the Republicans went about locking in majorities in state houses around the country, locking in majorities in the House by redistricting. I've referenced this dynamic in the past. You probably heard it in other places. Now you're going to really understand how they went about doing it. Very important to know. Very important to know both how they did it, what the Democrats are doing or not doing to fight it, to deal with it. Perhaps the sine qua non of what's going to happen in the years to come in terms of legislation and both in states across the country, but also in the federal government. Because until the Democrats figure out how to win the House back, it's just going to be a mess. So check that out. It is Friday. We'll be back live on Monday. Not sure if it'll be Michael or I. And over the weekend, it is going to be my daughter Mila's birthday party. So there's going to be a sleepover. There's going to be a lot of preteen, a lot of tweeners. I'm going to be dealing with a lot of tweeners. But it is the final day of vacation for me. Well, not quite. I mean, over the weekend, I'm going to be still on vacation. But you know what that means. On Monday or Tuesday, I'll be available to do Hayes, and I will have to shave. And my beard at this point is probably extremely thick. Because I haven't, I'm already now, when we're recording this, a week before I'm talking, it's already starting to come in. It's going to be a problem, right? How am I going to do that? What am I going to do? Go to a barber? Am I going to pour Nair all over it or whatever it is? Gross. No, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to shave with the only razor I've found that I enjoy shaving with, well, period, frankly, but particularly when my beard is this thick. Big razor companies have the annoying habit of putting out new models, raising their already high prices. But unlike those guys, Harry doesn't believe in upcharging. So they have made their existing razors. If you haven't tried Harry's in a while, you got to try them again. If you never tried it, then this is your day. They keep the prices exactly the same. Harry's five-blade razors include a softer flex hinge for more comfortable glide, a trimmer blade for hard-to-reach places. For me, that's, you know, like my nose area. I don't know where it is for other people. They shave maybe their ears. I don't know why would you do that. But lubricating strip, textured handle for more control when it's wet. Still just $2 a blade compared to $4 or more you'll pay at the drugstore. Quality 100% guaranteed. If you don't love your shave, they'll fully refund you. I love shaving with Harry's. Gave my dad a razor, a Harry's razor, for Father's Day. He loved it. Now we're a happy family for the first time in decades. Now, that's a bit of an exaggeration, but he really did love the Harry's. The Harry's starter set is an amazing deal. You get a weighted razor handle of your choice, moisturizing shave cream, three precision engineered five blade cartridges, and a travel cover just for $15. However, if you've never tried Harry's before, guess what? $5 off. Yeah. All you need is the promo code Majority Report. And go to harrys.com right now. Enter the code Majority Report at checkout. You get $5 off if it's your first time you're buying razors. So that's $10 for the cartridges, the razor handle, the lubricating strip, the shave cream. Are you kidding me? The travel cover. That's harrys.com, code Majority Report. All right, quick break. Then we're going to get to Dave Daly. And then Matt may have a special Matt pick for members. All right, folks. Enjoy this. We'll be back live next week. We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report on the phone. It's a pleasure to welcome to the program a contributing writer to the New York Times Magazine and author of his most recent Helping Children Succeed, What Works and Why, which is a bit of a follow-up to his previous book, How Children Succeed, Grit, Curiosity, and the Hidden Power of Character. Paul Tough, welcome to the program.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Paul, I want to start off by asking you, like, why couldn't you come up with a totally different title? But I'm joking. All right, let's start. No, let's go back and start with just sort of a broad overview of how children succeed, because that is where I think, if I'm not mistaken, the inspiration for obviously helping children succeed came from. Give me just the broad back of the cover a description of what you set out to do in How Children Succeed.
Sure. So How Children Succeed in some ways came out of my very first book, which was called Whatever It Takes, and was about this guy named Jeffrey Canada and the Harlem Children's Zone. So I'd done a bunch of reporting on education, and particularly on the education of kids growing up in difficult circumstances and poverty and other kinds of adversity. But I felt like there was something more going on, and I was encountering various research that was saying that, you know, so Jeff Canada was very focused in his schools on test scores as the one measure of whether his students were succeeding. And after that first book came out, I started encountering a lot of this research in economics and in psychology and in neuroscience that was suggesting that there was this other set of skills or qualities in kids, sometimes called non-cognitive skills, sometimes called character strengths, things like grit and curiosity and conscientiousness and self-control that were enormously important in whether children would succeed, but that weren't being measured on our standardized tests. So How Children Succeed was an attempt to look at all of that research, figure out what these skills were and whether they mattered and why, and then to report on some specific schools and, you know, mentors and pediatricians and other programs that were trying to develop these skills in kids.
And in terms of that first book, I mean, it's happening in what, I mean, I think that time, your first book, or I should say, I'm sorry, not your first book, but your, I guess your second book in that regard,
right,
came out, and really, I guess the first book, yeah, I mean, but during a pretty intense period of the educational reform debate. I mean, it's not that that debate has not subsided, but the idea of the problematic nature of particularly high stakes testing. Seems to be there seems to be a slightly different disposition towards it now than then, and I'm curious as to sort of how what you found, at least in terms of like non-cognitive qualities, which are much harder, right, to quantify, and the idea that inputs in the form of low income students makes a significant difference to what the outputs are in terms of how the kids turn out. I mean, give me a sense of how those, where those two ideas fit, particularly at the time.
Yeah, it's a good question. So you're right. It was a weird period. It continues to be a strange period. I mean, I feel like in some ways the last decade of education politics has been a complicated one, but certainly it came out at a time where when the Obama administration was, you know, in some ways doing things differently than the Bush administration, but in lots of ways was doubling down on the same kind of policies on No Child Left Behind. You know, they had their race to the top strategy, but it was based on a lot of the very similar premises that these standardized tests were the most effective and important way to hold schools accountable, that we couldn't help poor kids do better unless, you know, we assessed schools and teachers and students based on these tests. And so, but at the same time, you know, I felt in getting reactions to that, to How Children Succeed, there were a lot of people within that education bureaucracy, including in Washington, who were really interested in these skills and were convinced, I think, like a lot of people were, that, yeah, there was something missing in the way that we were doing these tests. So, I mean, I think it continues to be a muddled time in education politics, but I think it especially was then, where the administration had sort of decided that they just couldn't veer away from this national strategy of tying everything to these tests. But at the same time, they were kind of convinced by some of the research that something else was going on. They just didn't know how to reflect that in policy.
And what also sort of fascinates me, and then I want to move on to the sort of the you know, the specific data and how one helps children succeed. But what strikes me is that relationship between poverty and the non-cognitive qualities, right? Because that to me is it's not only sort of essential in terms of education, but it's also been a very large part of our politics. I mean, you know, just even the idea of Paul Ryan telling what turns out to be a misinterpreted and false story about a kid with a brown bag lunch, and the sort of the implications about sort of dignity and sort of more some type of moral qualities in relationship to poverty. There's a whole lot of that that's jumbled up there, and so, I mean, and the the relationship between poverty and sort of these non-cognitive qualities is, I don't know, some people on the right, to a large extent, see the poverty as a result of the absence of these non-cognitive qualities. And and then it also, I think there's an understanding, and I think your research or the research that you researched shows it's also sort of the opposite, or it is, in fact, the opposite.
Right. Yeah. So, and this is a lot of this, what I was trying to understand better in this new book, Helping Children Succeed. Because, yeah, so clearly there is, the research suggests that there is something that happens when kids grow up in not necessarily poverty, but in any kind of adversity. You know, when their homes and their communities and their schools are chaotic and unstable, and you know, they don't have the kind of material resources that better off kids have, that affects them in some way, right? And we all can kind of agree that this happens. But once you start talking about, well, how does it affect them, and who has responsibility for how that affects them, I think it gets into territory that is, it's easy to lose track of the science, you know, because I think we, on both sides of the political aisle, we tend to feel, you know, we tend to feel like emotionally about kids in poverty, and we should. And so I think that kind of emotional, like moralistic realm often comes into it. And so one of the things that I think is tricky about this research is that, you know, at the same time that we're talking about non-cognitive skills, we also talk about this word character. And I think there are some good reasons for doing that, for looking at these, you know, things like self-control as a character strength, and the educators who talk that way, I get why they're doing that. But once you start talking about, you know, the fact that, like, okay, so growing up in a unstable and chaotic household, we know, like, that makes it harder for kids on average when they get to kindergarten to exercise self-control, to focus, to sit still, to, you know, deal well with setbacks, right? And so if we look at that as just kind of like a scientific neurological fact, that's really interesting and important. And it tells us, well, we should support families early on in order to help kids have better early environments so that they are more likely to show up in kindergarten being able to do well, right? But if we look at it through another lens of like, well, so poor kids don't have self-control, that means, and having self-control is a good thing, it means you have good character, so that means that poor kids have less good character than rich kids, right? Which is not actually not true, and also not a useful direction to go in terms of any kind of political debate. So these two things, the kind of like moralistic way of looking at it and the scientific way of looking at it, I think often get conflated. And so one of the things I'm trying to do in this new book is to sort of unweave those strands and give us a more practical way to look at what happens to kids who are growing up in adversity, and to figure out what the rest of us can do to help those kids do better.
Well, let's talk about that specifically. How are kids who grow up in that type of adversity adversely affected? I think you know, I've spoken to a lot of educators over the years on this program, and the nearly all of them, and you know, and to a certain extent, that's a function of the educators I've invited on the program. But nearly all of them, I think, will say if you give me the area code and tell me or the zip code and tell me what the median income is there, I will tell you how well the school does. And I will tell you how the outputs are. And you hear things like, you know, a kid living in poverty enters into school with a massive listening vocabulary deficit. Just those, your research goes even beyond that element of it.
Yeah. So, so I want to say two things about it. One is, I absolutely agree that statistically that's true, right? That certain zip codes, certain income levels, certain neighborhoods, kids are much more likely to have struggles at school. But I think it's also, and I think we do understand more, and I'll try and say more about what those pathways are, why that happens. But I think the risk is becoming too fatalistic, right? And so I do think that it's important to acknowledge that there are some kids who are growing up in real adversity, and because of Maybe it's because of luck, but more often because of certain things that happen in their lives or in their families, they're more likely to do well. And so figuring out what it is that makes those kids those outliers, I think, is a really useful question. But then, yeah, right, so it leads to this question of why. Why is it that growing up in a low-income neighborhood means the kids struggle in school or are more likely to struggle in school? And I think there are lots of different theories, and again, those theories often have more emotion than they do science behind them. But what I get from the scientific research is that there are lots of things that are impacting how well kids do when they're growing up in poverty or in chaotic circumstances, but that the two most important ones both have to do with stress. This research about stress neurobiology, how stress growing up in intensely stressful situations affects the development of our stress response system, and that in turn affects the development of this set of skills called executive functions, which kind of develop later on in life to these non-cognitive skills like self-control and perseverance. That science is really pretty powerful, and it clearly starts in early childhood when kids in the first couple of years of life experience what doctors sometimes call toxic stress that changes them biologically and makes it much more difficult. It sort of amps up their fight or flight response, which makes sense in a stressful, you know, dangerous situation, but does not work well when you're in kindergarten. The other thing that makes a big difference is the adults around them, so that when you're in a relationship with parents or mentors or grandparents where there's a lot of what is sometimes called serve and return parenting, this sort of back and forth, face-to-face, warm, hanging out on the, you know, living room rug nurturance, that has an enormously positive effect, again, like biologically, mentally, psychologically. It makes it easier for kids to deal with stress. It makes it easier for kids to deal with the kind of stresses that come along in kindergarten. So those two things are not the only factors that influence how well low-income kids do in school, but they are, I think, the most important ones, and they're the earliest ones. They're the ones that we can see happening, you know, including in the first year of life.
What constitutes toxic stress? I mean, what level of stress are we talking about?
It's a good question, and there's no, that we don't have a scientific definition for, but the it's stress that is both intense and that is chronic. So, like having, if you're a kid in a pretty sort of stable situation and home and family life, and you have one intense bad experience, you know, you're in a car accident or, you know, a natural disaster or something like that, it tends not to impact you in a permanent kind of way. But so it's more the kind of chronicness of this stress, that when you're in a situation where every day there is yelling or you're being abused or neglected or you're just not, you know, there's just chaos around you every day, that is closer to the definition of toxic stress. That's the stuff that really starts to impact how kids do, because, you know, we have these stress response systems that are kind of like adversity thermostats early on. They're looking around us for like clues as to what life is going to be like, and it really is striking in the research how it is, you know, more than like abuse or trauma or anything else. It's instability. It's just like when things are not stable and when they feel chaotic on any given day, including just being sort of ignored and not paid attention to by the adults in your life. That is the kind of thing that sends these, that equates to toxic stress, and it sends these messages to these kids developing brains and bodies that life is going to be hard and you need to prepare for it.
So, in other words, it's, if every time you hear a rustle in the brush, a tiger comes out, there's not going to be a time in your life where you hear that rustle in the brush where you don't start running.
Absolutely, yeah. And I think it is, you know, this system within us was, you know, formed back in those days where we were living around tigers, you know, it's about like being prepared for danger. And there are a lot of kids right now who are living in situations where they are, you know, it's not tigers, but it sure feels that way to them. And it's similarly threatening. And so the only way that our stress response systems can respond to that is not by being very rational and figuring out exactly what's a tiger and what's not a tiger. It's just be scared all the time, be prepared for any danger, which, again, is good when you're surrounded by tigers, not good when you're trying to do finger painting in pre-K.
And then does the implications of that sort of defense mechanism, which is, you know, you can't turn off at that point, or certainly a pre-K kid or a kindergarten kid can't turn off. Does that then, does it then exacerbate? It becomes sort of almost a self-fulfilling prophecy, or it becomes some type of, I mean, that's maybe not the right word, but it becomes some type of feedback loop that continues that dynamic.
Yeah, and it continues. It I think reaches a new stage when kids get to school, and some schools, a minority of schools, but some schools are pretty good at figuring out how to help kids who, first of all, figuring out how to understand that that's what's going on. That if kids are coming in and they're not able to, you know, regulate themselves, it's not that they're like bad kids or from a bad culture or you know, they're just poorly behaved. It's that they are, you know, they've grown up in these circumstances that make it difficult for them to regulate themselves, and so they need help from the adults around them, the teachers around them, to do that. And if you get a teacher like that and you get a school like that, there's actually a lot that schools can do to help those kids. You know, kindergarten is by no means too late to help those kids regulate. But most schools don't do that, and most schools instead tend to label these kids. They, you know, it's difficult for them to learn at the same pace, because when they're trying to, you know, learn their letters or their numbers, their minds are kind of jumbled up with stress and emotions and fear. And so as these kids fall behind, they're more likely to get tracked into the low-performing classes. And so I think there's this sort of negative feedback loop that can happen for a lot of schools with these kids, and there are a lot of schools where this is not some tiny minority of the kids, where a large number of students in any school come from these difficult backgrounds, have been exposed to lots of toxic stress growing up, and then that tends to, I think, make things even worse, because if you have a whole school where kids are poorly regulated, that makes it difficult for even the kids who did not have that same kind of adversity. They're now surrounded by kids who are freaked out on any given day.
And it's much that it's obviously, from a resource standpoint, in terms of the teachers, it is that much harder to address.
Absolutely. It's you know, I mean, there are some fantastic teachers who can do a great job with kids who have had that kind of experience. But it's a much harder kind of teaching. And it's especially hard when you've got, you know, 20 of those kids or 30 of those kids in your class, and not just one or two that you can give extra attention to.
Is there, you said kindergarten's not too late. When is too late? I mean, is there a point that is too late?
I don't think there is, no. I mean, you know, I'm only looking at in this book at K-12 education, so I don't know much about how people change, like, in their 20s and 30s, though I do believe that people can change in their 20s and 30s. But certainly up through high school, there are lots of opportunities. You know, I write about various mentoring programs that happen with high school kids. Adolescence is another time where kids are kind of reflecting on themselves in a way that they can't when they're younger, and they're able to really change their way of thinking about the world, change their behavior in significant ways. It's not ideal because, you know, by the so I wrote about, for instance, this mentoring program that worked with kids in very bad circumstances in very poor neighborhoods on the south side of Chicago. It was working with them in high school. It often had, you know, really profound effects on how they felt and how they did and how motivated they were to do in school. But if you get to age 16 and, you know, you've not been able to really focus on school ever, and you're in mostly low-performing public schools in the south side of Chicago, it's not too late for you in terms of, you know, you can accomplish much more than you would if you hadn't had this sort of transformation, but you haven't had a good education. You know, you just haven't had a good experience in school, and so there's a lot you don't know. There's a lot of skills you don't have. So, yeah, these two ideas, I think, often seem contradictory, that, you know, A, it's never too late. You can help kids all the way through high school. But B, it is a lot more effective and a lot more efficient and a lot more cost-effective to intervene with those kids early on and help create environments for them in early childhood and elementary school that are going to help them have the kind of cognitive and non-cognitive skills that they need to do well in school and in life.
I want to talk a little bit about what examples are of things that would have that impact on students and what it would take to sort of scale those things. But maybe I was a little remiss in not starting with the idea of what, when you're suggesting you can help children succeed, what is What is success? I mean, how is that defined?
So it's a great question. I think like it's easy to get sort of philosophical about what success is, and I don't think there's sort of a simple, you know, numbers definition. But mostly what the success that I'm talking about, especially when we're talking about low income kids, is educational success, and educational success meaning education to give kids options in life. So it doesn't mean, you know, that you're only successful if you go to certain schools or have certain jobs. But I think if you don't have, if you're, you know, getting to the end of high school and you don't feel like you have options, if you don't, if you're, you know, how you've done in school has not given you options of what you want to do with the rest of your life, that's a problem. You know, that's not success. And so when kids do feel in high school like they've got options for what comes next, that to me feels like success. And so some of them, you know, may go on and get BAs and beyond. Some of them might not. But if they don't feel like that's at least a possibility, that's a problem for me.
So, all right. So how does one deal with a kid who at, particularly in their early childhood, has been subjected to this type of toxic, stress? They have been, denied, a significant amount of serve and return parenting, because, the parents, I mean, I would imagine there are a couple of things that sort of create those environments. One, you know, there's a lot of data that show that poverty creates that type of stress. And I think people even can, you know, you don't have to live in poverty to understand that money is a source of stress, and that stress bleeds into relationship stress and whatnot. And I mean, it seems also, you know, if you're working two jobs, or both parents are working two or three jobs a day, and the idea of taking, you know, a half an hour to sit down with the kid on the you know, and be feel like comfortable and stress free yourself, very difficult. So what can schools do to deal with that? But also, how, you know, like, I feel that from my perspective, like, it would have been good to know what the best stuff I can do as a parent is. And there's no, you know, I mean, even if you Google it, you're going to come up with like a million different answers.
Yeah. So I want to answer the question about what schools and teachers can do, but I just want to precede that by talking about early childhood, because so a good third of this book is about interventions that take place in early childhood. And I feel like, we have this, when we're thinking about policy, we have this way of thinking like, okay, the government's responsibility starts, you know, the first day of kindergarten or maybe pre-K if you're lucky. And what happens before then, like, we can't do anything about it. That's just, you know, up to kids and families to work out. But that approach is really out of step with the science, which says that what is happening in those first 2, 3, 4 years is enormously important, and that if we want to help kids, it's the most effective, most important time to intervene. And there are lots of interventions that can happen in those early years, and they are mostly about supporting parents, and supporting parents mostly kind of like emotionally and psychologically. So I write about a couple of different home visiting programs where home visitors will spend time with parents and kids and babies, just being supportive, talking about different strategies to develop attachment and closeness, and serve and return parenting between that parent and that infant. And these programs really work. They have a huge effect on how kids do. They also have a huge effect, like, biologically. You can see the changes in kids' cortisol levels, their stress hormone levels, when their parents get involved in one of these programs and start to change their behavior and change their attitudes. It's interesting to try to figure out exactly why these programs work. There's some of it is just information, you know. So you talked about, like, all parents, I did too, like, you just don't know what you're doing and you want to understand better, like, what do I do when my kid is crying? What do I do when my kid is, you know, refusing to go to bed? And so giving some part of these home visiting programs is just about giving that information. But I think it's also true that a lot of parents who are living in poverty are stressed out themselves. They're often, you know, depressed. Their lives have all of the chaos in them that often comes along with poverty. And so it's just emotionally, psychologically tough to be a parent in those circumstances. So some of what these home visitors do is just give these parents a sense of themselves as being, you know, good, qualified, competent parents. And the nice thing about parenting is that when you when a parent can change their behavior, and whether they're rich or poor, and develop this kind of attachment producing parenting, the payoff is not like, okay, whether they're going to graduate from high school or college down the road. The payoff is also immediate. Like, you get along better with your child. Your child is happier. Your child does sleep better, and home life just gets better. And so that a pretty minor push from a home visitor over the course, like some of these programs are, you know, 10 half-hour long visits, can have this huge effect on how parents do, and then on how kids do. It can really change the dynamic in the home.
And where do I find that online?
Pre-K program.
Where do I find that online? Right.
So if you go to my website, which is paultuff.com, the whole text of my book, Helping Children Succeed, is online. And in the text, there are links to these different programs. There are videos of these different programs. So that's the first place that I would send anybody.
I can't get my 3-year-old to go to sleep these days. I'm not exactly sure why. But that's not what we're here for.
I hear you.
All right, but so,
I'll come over later and I'll...
All right, great. This is going to be perfect.
Moon, we'll do a little.
So in the absence of those programs, which I imagine they are far and few between, what then do teachers do, and what could teachers do, A, in theory, and B, in practice? Do we have the ability to allow teachers to do that?
Great questions. Okay, so... I would say a few things. One is that in early childhood, how to intervene is pretty close to an exact science. Like we even though you're right that we don't spend enough on these programs, they are pretty few and far between. We do have pretty ironclad evidence that like certain changes in behavior in parents, certain approaches by home visitors have a huge effect on how kids do. We have pretty good ideas in terms of what can be useful in school, but it's not quite as ironclad. So one of the things that I'm trying to do in this book is rather than say, here's the perfect program, here's the perfect pedagogy, here's the perfect curriculum, is to say, like, let's look at all of this research and all of these things that seem successful and try and get some basic principles that any teacher, any school leader can use. So, and the first one that I'll say is just simply awareness of how this science works, I think helps. You know, I think that if you're a teacher with a lot of stressed out kids, especially if you're teaching in a low income school, it's hard not to take it personally, right? These kids are often being like super obnoxious and major pains in the neck. And so if you're that teacher in that room, it's hard not to take that stuff personally. But to me, understanding the science and understanding that these are not, you know, yes, kids have free will, but they are also responding and reacting to a lifetime of stress, and that has predictable kind of responses. They are more likely to feel threatened by criticism or by, confrontation. That, I think, changes sort of intuitively your approach as a teacher. It makes you more likely to try to dial confrontations down rather than dial them up. You're less likely to have, you know, confrontations with a kid in front of the whole classroom where suddenly it's a big issue, and instead find ways to make them feel safe and connected and trusted. So my hope is that some of that will just kind of come instinctively to teachers. But beyond that, what I derive from all of the research and the programs that I read about is that there are two main toolboxes for teachers or for educators to use when they're dealing with kids who are growing up in real adversity. And one toolbox has to do with relationships, and the other has to do with pedagogy, and specifically with challenge. So the relationship one is what psychologists will tell us is that, you know, having a sense of belonging, feeling related and connected to the adults around you is enormously important for every kid, and it's especially important for kids who are growing up in adversity. And there's a lot that teachers can do to create that feeling, to create an atmosphere of sort of trust and even warmth and connectedness, not only between the teacher and the student, but among the students as well, to create a sense of sort of community and connection within a school. That can sound very kind of mushy and touchy-feely, but it works. You know, it really makes a huge difference in how kids feel and how well they do in school, how likely they are to apply themselves has a lot to do with how they feel. Then the second toolbox that I talk about has to do with how you actually teach, with what happens in the classroom. And the key ingredient there, I think, is challenge. I think there are a lot of schools that when they're faced with kids who are behind and who are struggling in lots of ways, their approach is to hold them back, is to not sort of give them too challenging, too difficult material. But that actually, I think, can often backfire. And what is more effective with kids is to give them a sense of challenge. I mean, challenges that they can meet, but to give them the message that, like, you can actually do hard, complicated, interesting work. And when kids are in a school situation where they feel like they are doing projects and taking on work that is meaningful and challenging and interesting and, like, a little beyond them, and that they have a teacher who believes that they can actually achieve accomplish that difficult work, creates a level of motivation for some kids, and I think most kids, that enables them to display these kind of non-cognitive skills. They're more likely to be self-controlled. They're more likely to persevere through difficult tasks if they feel like they're doing work that really is meaningful.
I mean, when I hear those two sort of those two elements of what you're talking about, the parent intervention, which is outside of both, I mean, literally outside of our educational system, at least as we structure it now, both temporally and physically. And then the idea of challenge the students a little bit more, you know, make them stand on their tippy toes to touch it or, you know, jump just a little bit. It seems like the way that we have structured our education system in this country and our perspective on it is designed specifically to prevent both of those things from happening, right? Like we look at education as something that is distinct from the person's home at the kid's life at home. And, you know, so we specifically don't talk about, you know, what we would call here, I mean, you know, sending people to parents' home to tell them how to sort of, I guess, like, raise their kids on some level, is antithetical to the way that we perceive what should happen in society, right? Like, that's a different type of social program. And challenging kids runs completely contrary to the incentive structure that we've created for teachers, because by challenging the kid, what you're doing is risking the funding of the school and risking your own job, it seems to me, the way that we've structured that. How do we, is there even any I feel like there is a political force out there that is sort of pushing this in that way. I mean, to look at the you know, but do we have a chance of reforming the way that we look at education to head in that direction? And is there, it still feels like the tide's going the other direction.
Yeah. You're right. And I mean, one of the things that really struck me in doing the reporting for Helping Children Succeed was uncovering this research about just what goes on in regular American classrooms on a day-to-day basis. And school is boring. School is not designed to be challenging and interesting and deep for most kids in most schools in the United States. And so I do think that some of that has to do with federal education policy, and I think that, you know, the push toward focusing on standardized tests over the past 15 years has made that worse. But there's some interesting research that I read about in the book that some of it is just cultural too. Like, the way we learn math in the United States and have for decades, before No Child Left Behind, there's just this American way of learning math, and it's different than the Japanese way of learning math, and it's designed to be not challenging. You know, it's designed to not give kids those moments of sort of struggle and confusion that cognitive psychologists tell us is actually how you learn. You know, you have that moment where you have to figure out for yourself, like, what is a fraction and how does it work, you know? And so some of this very basic stuff about, like, how an eighth grade math lesson unfolds, and I read about this a little bit in the book, it's different in different cultures, and we have a way of doing it that I think is sort of singularly poorly structured to help kids not only learn math, and compete, you know, with our global competitors, but also to feel a sense of themselves as students, right? Like when you're learning math by actually trying to get the big picture of what a fraction is and trying to, you know, have discussions with your classmates about how we might think about fractions, all stuff that happens very, very rarely in most American schools, that gives you not only a better sense of fractions, it also gives you a sense of yourself as somebody who can figure things out and who can accomplish complicated things and work in groups and challenge a teacher and, you know, not just receive wisdom from a worksheet. So yeah,
why do you think that is?
That we have a big challenge.
Why do you think that is? I mean, what is it? Something in our culture?
Why is it that Americans think that way?
Well, yeah. Why? I mean, you know, these things
don't. It's a good question.
There must be some, I don't know, cultural, intellectual history reason why we developed in that manner.
It's a great question. The guy who wrote this book named James Stigler, the book is called The Teaching Gap. It's a great book. And so, I mean, some of his theory and the theory of other people is that we Americans in general, and I think American parents, including definitely affluent parents, are anxious about kids struggling. Struggle for us, like the kids who are struggling in school are the ones who are messed up. You know, those are the kids who like we look down on. And in other cultures, you know, we look at struggle as this sign of the kids who are struggling are the ones who are learning, who are doing better. And that I think, I don't know where that idea came from originally, but I think it does go deep. But, you know, all that said, I do think that there is this push in a lot of schools in the United States right now to rethink that and to encourage kids to go deeper and to accept struggle and failure as part of the process of learning. The problem in the context of my book is that it's happening more often in private schools, in well-off or in public schools in well-off suburbs. And actually there is this kind of, this pretty big change that is happening in affluent education in the United States, where parents and teachers are moving away from standardized tests and moving more toward, you know, getting kids to take on challenging projects and to be okay with failing and to, go deeper into particular subjects. In some ways, it's this kind of exciting moment in education. We don't know exactly where it's going to go, and it's this, you know, moment of like a lot of experimentation. Some experiments will work better than others. But the big problem for me with this movement is that it's happening mostly among well-off kids. And so what that's going to do, I think, unless we can figure out ways to get these same sorts of tools into public schools that are serving low-income kids, and I think we could, it's only going to make the divide between how well rich and poor kids do greater, vaster.
This may be outside of your portfolio. I mean, there are two things that occur to me when you say that we're seeing this develop in more affluent schools. One is the dynamic in Chicago, where Rahm Emanuel and Penny Pritzker and the folks there shut down a lot of schools and pared back on a lot of the sort of softer qualities of the public schools, yet they're sending their kids to private schools where they don't have that same sort of regimented notion of like, got to hit this grade or you, literally the school closes. And Arnie Duncan, you know, complaining, I guess, a couple years ago, which was around the turning point of like, now, you know, he said suddenly, he was trying to make himself out to be a champion of low-income kids by saying, like, well, suddenly we have, you know, parents in the wealthy suburbs who are complaining about these standards, and that's why we're hearing about it more, or something to that effect. I'm paraphrasing. But
right, when the opt-out movement was
exactly
mostly in wealthy areas, yeah.
I mean, and so is it, I mean, what's it going to take to have those ideas migrate? I mean, right, theoretically, right, the charter schools were set up to be labs that would theoretically produce solutions like this one. I don't know specifically this one came from there, but solutions like this one that were then scalable and then adopted system-wide. Why is that not happening? Is it that the ideas haven't gained enough currency, or is that there's still this sort of notion that is sort of ironically built into it that, like, well, you can't give this type of freedom and soft metrics for success for poor people. I mean, what's the loggerhead here?
I would say it's two things. I think one is that I think it partly is that. I think we are skeptical that kids who come from poverty or come from educational backgrounds where they, you know, are still missing a lot of the basics. We think that we find it hard to believe that those kids could benefit from a academic structure where they are being challenged in a deeper way and, you know, sort of working on projects and working in groups and doing all these strategies that are part of deeper learning. And, you know, I think there is some truth to that. I think you do need a certain amount of kind of basic knowledge in order to do deep work. I think that you can solve that problem, and I don't think that it's right that we, you know, should have two very different educational approaches for kids in different sides of the economic divide. But I think there is some sort of assumptions about what kids can do, what kind of work that is holding us back. The other thing I think, and this is, you know, having now written about this stuff and been very optimistic about different sorts of interventions at different periods, I think there is something about the basic premise, not just of charter schools, but of a lot of education research in general, that like somehow the solution is going to come from finding the right approach to education in some laboratory somewhere, you know, in some particular school, in some particular notion, and then scaling that up in a huge way. You know, I've written about, I've kind of wanted to believe that for a long time, and I think that And I think there's still, you know, we should still be researching, we should still be looking for models that work, and we should still be trying to use those models to improve education for every kid. But I do think that education just doesn't work in as regimented a way as that. There isn't one curriculum that works for every kid. Part of the reason that, you know, the schools that are succeeding with these deeper learning strategies are that they do have more resources. You know, it is easier to do it if you've got, if you're a private school with lots of money and lots of freedom and parents who are on board with all of these things. So I don't think that it's just as simple as like someone is stopping us from putting deeper learning ideas into other schools. But I think part of what's holding us back is this. Part of what's holding us back, I think, is those assumptions, those wrong assumptions about what poor kids can achieve compared to well-off kids. But part of it, I think, is this yearning for sort of the perfect solution that we can just find in one place and then ramp up and extend to the rest of the world.
And how much is sort of like there's a broad ideological issue here too, it seems to me, right? I mean, like we hear people rail against the idea of cradle to grave. And in some respects, it's like, well, okay, let's put the grave part aside for a moment. Not necessarily cradle, but pretty shortly thereafter, there is a role for government in enhancing the prospects and, you know, fulfillment, you know, however you want to measure that, of people's lives. And that, to me, it seems, is a very problematic thing for a huge swath of our body politic to accept.
You're talking about in early childhood specifically, intervening in early childhood.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you're right. And I mean, the only thing I would add to that is I would say that there is, I think the basic ideological framework that you're putting on it is right. But I think there's an additional problem, which is that I think on the left as well, I think there is an anxiety about doing this sort of home, investing a lot in home visiting programs, because I think they can be seen by some people as, you know, cultural imperialism, that it's about a certain type of a certain class or a certain culture telling another class or culture how to behave. And so there's this, I think, anxiety about funding those programs. And, you know, having been to a lot of these home visiting programs and, you know, sat in on home visits, they just don't feel that way at all. They don't feel, you know, they don't feel like one culture telling another culture what to do. They feel like, you know, a friend visiting another friend and being very sort of warm and supportive. But I think the fact that there is sort of ideological anxiety about those programs from both the left and the right has made it especially difficult for there to be much of a constituency. You know, I think there's a huge constituency. There has developed that there's this huge kind of bipartisan constituency for pre-K, more on the left than on the right, but including, you know, in states like Oklahoma and Georgia, there's been this big push for pre-K in the last 10 years, and that's great. But I think getting beyond that to how to think about the first 4 years, that's a place, you know, there are certainly advocates who are out there. Hillary Clinton's talked about putting more money in those early years, so I can maybe be optimistic about what might happen in the next few years. But there is not a big constituency saying, like, the first couple of years of life is somewhere that the federal government needs to spend a lot more money and put a lot more energy.
Paul Tough, the book is Helping Children Succeed, What Works and Why. We will put a link to it at majority.fm. People can head over to paultough.com, which we'll also put a link to at majority.fm. Thanks so much for your time today. Really interesting work.
Thank you. Really enjoyed the conversation.
Hello, you. I'm Sam Seder. Looking for smart, progressive talk that is occasionally amusing? Well, subscribe to our YouTube feed. Subscribe to our podcast. Like us on Facebook. And just generally enjoy us.